when we heard that they were coming close to us here in Derbyshire and East Staffordshire, they're going to Sheffield on the 4th of September and over in Nottingham on the 25th. We decided you've got to get Midge into a studio near his house, a little compact Bijou studio down in Bath. See, I said it properly. And asked him if he was ready to go back out on the road.
I'm always ready to go out on the road, actually. You know, it's saying that, I think I'm prepared, but getting the band prepared is a whole different thing. There's a lot of groundwork to be done before you even dream of stepping on stage. You know, the technology has changed how we perform these days. We use a lot of laptops on stage, which generate the sounds that we play. And that's just, that can be a... It's a joy when you've got it working, but with computers, they can be a little volatile, but they take an awful lot of TLC, an awful lot of care and attention to get them to do what you want them to do, and we're in the middle of doing that right now. But yes, mentally and emotionally prepared.
Because when you first started to put your songs down, you know, this was all science fiction, memory sticks and things like that, wasn't it?
Oh, it was stuff we dreamed of. I mean, we were such technophiles. We loved everything that bleeped and blinked and, you know, made noises and things, little things you could carry in your pockets. That was like, it's a boy's dream, Ultravox. It's just fantastic. When you go to Japan, you come back with all this stuff. You didn't know what it did, but you had to have it. And that hasn't changed. That hasn't really gone away. So, yeah, I mean, it's one of those things that, you know, it's an absolute joy to kind of, you know, get part of. But it's only an element of what you do. The writing of the songs is really, really important. You know, how you perform them is academic. How you record them is kind of academic. It's the same process. Without a good idea, it doesn't matter what you record or how you record it or what you record it on. You can be in the best studio in the world and you will make something that nobody's interested in.
Because you've got the technology, I suppose you feel the need to use it, but over the time since you first recorded those songs, I mean, you've done the songs in completely different ways. You've stripped them right down. You've used different instruments as well.
Yeah.
Do you now incorporate all of that knowledge into performance?
No, I have to say no. There's something odd, I think, because Ultravox, in a way, is in the minority of how these songs are performed, because Ultravox had a life, from when I joined in 79, we had a life of like 6 years. So we had a six-year period where we played those songs the way they were supposed to be played. And now I've had 25, 27 years of playing them many, many different ways. The interesting thing is going back and playing them how they should be played, and dropping all the changes and the adaptations that you've made to it to keep it interesting for you. So the idea of going back and saying, well, how did we actually do that? How did we make that sound? How did we create that noise? How did we make that atmosphere? And go back there and use modern technology to do that is a challenge, and it's a great challenge. So in a way, this is a novel thing for me to go back and play it as it should be played.
It's like playing back how skilled you were all those years ago, because you now are technically more proficient, you play more instruments, but I suppose you're having to forget all of that.
Well, you don't forget it. I mean, the knowledge is always there, and the process of how you do it. I mean, there's an education you go through. It's like an apprenticeship music, really. You know, you never get your certificate at the end of it saying, that's you, you're done, you know. You just carry on learning because, you know, technology changes at such a vast, you know, rapid rate. So all of that knowledge that you've accrued is still goes into the show. You know, your ideas on lighting and staging and performance and how to put, you know, a selection of songs together to make an interesting show. It's not just about what songs you play. It's about the effect and the emotions that those songs give people, and having them so that the peaks are really peaked and the lows are textural and atmospheric and give people a chance to chill out and just sit and listen and watch the light show and all of that stuff. So trying to get the whole thing in context has always been high on our agenda, and it's still that way, you know.
Straight back to my conversation with Midge, and don't you think he sounds a bit like David Tennant? If I didn't tell you it was Midge, would you think I was talking about Doctor Who or anything else? But Midge and the rest of Ultravox back together again for a new tour, which gets near us on the 4th of September in Sheffield and on the 25th of September to the Royal Centre in Nottingham. And I asked him what it was like to get back on stage with his fellow bandmates.
Well, once we recognise each other, it's quite easy. it's been a long time. it's painful. It's a nightmare because you spend half of your time looking at a computer with your head down and pressing buttons and hitting keyboards and stuff and not really making music until you've got all of that technical stuff, the nuts and bolts, done and tucked away. And then you start playing and thinking about the music and thinking about the emotions that you're trying to convey. That stuff becomes a bit like a 9-to-5 job. But it's an interesting 9-to-5 job. And then once the music starts, it's wonderful. It just washes over you. It's such a powerful noise we make.
What about costuming then for this new tour? Have you gone back into the wardrobe?
Yeah, I think we're going to go in caftans this time. We're looking, it's that Demis Roussos look I think we're going for. You know, the kind of tent, and then nobody can see how many pounds you've put on over the years. That's the bottom of the heap, I have to say. Maybe back in the day that was more important. These days, I think we'll get the music right, get the staging right, and then we'll worry about, you know, what you feel comfortable in and how you want to look as you walk on stage. It doesn't really matter how you look anyway, because you come off drenched. You come off looking like a soaked rabbit.
That's why we've prepped you in this small studio today, just to get you ready for a couple of hours.
Well, right now, this sauna that I'm sitting speaking from, you know, it's doing two things. It's getting me drenched, and then it's also making me lose a few pounds while I'm doing some interviews.
With going out on tour, though, I mean, things have changed in the time since you first started. Would you like to be coming into the industry now, or are you glad you've done it the way that you've done it?
My eldest daughter has been kind of, you know, around the periphery of the industry for quite a few years now, and I can see it through her eyes, and it's a very, very different world. The ideas of, you know, having a record company knock on your door and wave a contract in your face is vague, to say the least, these days. You have to be skilled at all things. You have to be a master of many, many tasks. So you have to be able to market yourself. You have to be able to produce your own records. You have to make them in your bedroom. You have to do it with absolutely no budget whatsoever. You have to be incredibly skilled at marketing. So when you do eventually get the odds show that you can sell some CDs at the end of it. You have to be skilled in the internet. You have to be on Facebook and all of these social media things. And it's exhausting just talking about it, never mind sitting down doing it. So rather than my day where you just rehearsed all day as a professional musician and then did your gigs at the end of the week or whatever, you know, instead of rehearsing all day, you have to do all of this stuff instead. And that takes huge dedication. So it's not a task and not a job for the faint-hearted.
Does it make musicians today more business-minded?
I think it has to, because you do not make money from record sales. It just doesn't exist. We have an entire generation, maybe two generations now, who've grown up never having purchased a piece of music ever, because they get it on the internet for free. And they don't see the damage that that does, because eventually, one day, yeah, all music may be free, but it's all going to be old. Because if there's no investment in teaching people how to do all these, how to, you know, create all these skills that they have to do for themselves, and there's no investment in new talents, you know, the next Kate Bush is sitting in a bedroom somewhere, you know, scared to go out because she's writing these great songs, but nobody's hearing them. And the next Led Zeppelin's playing in a garage somewhere because he can't get a gig because all the cover bands, the look-alike, sound-alike bands are all taking their space. So it's a very different world now. You have to be not only have a thick skin, you have to be a multitasker to go out there and do it.
And a final question, talking of royalties, Bradley Wiggins, is he paying you anything about those sideburns or not?
No, his are much chunkier than mine. His are a bit more Edwardian, and mine, I think, at the time were a bit more Spock.
A bit more angular, that's what it is. Midge, thanks for talking to us. Don't sweat too much.
I'm saving it up for the tour, yeah.
And we'll talk to you soon. Cheers, mate.
Thanks a lot. Cheers.